Yeah, hello everybody. So, as you can see, I broke my promise, and instead of starting speaking about network, I will again speak about linear model because I started, writing the little detail that I forgot to say or were not very clear in the previous classes. And my idea was to discuss them at the end when we talk again of particular gene expression thing when we talk about normalization. But I realized that there are too many, and I better finish them now because next week, the next 2 weeks are midterms, and so we will not have a class during these 2 weeks. And I wanted to finish the topic so essentially to round up the system. Okay, so I'm sorry if I disappoint you if you wanted to know network, but I promise to do it in next class. Okay, we have seen two ways to do linear models, essentially. The way in R that we use for a single gene or for a few genes, like I show you this in the case of plant. I show you with the CT value of plant. I show you with weight and sex, and I show you or hide all the combination of things. And I also show you the case of the number of cells. Well, we did with the gene, no, with the number of cells, with the number of cells in brain. So, this was the example that I give you. And then I give you another example using Lima. And this was the data of Atacan. What is the that was expression of microRNA under different diets and age and tissues and blah. Okay. So and as you see, they share data, but they have several differences. As you see, one has a formula, the other has a design matrix. So I want to try to combine them and explain how we move one or why we have these two things. So in the first difference in the LM, in the plain linear model, the data is a data frame, one column for every condition. So you have, let's say, one column for Y and one column for each one of the X variables. Okay. Then factors or whatever. And if they are factored, they will be handled magically. For LM50, that is a matrix. And it's kind of funny because essentially the data is in the rows. I mean, what I mean is this. In linear model, the Y is a column in the data frame. In LM50, the value that we want to model is in the row, one for every gene. So things are kind of sideways. You have to be careful with that. Just this is not super critical, but you have to be careful when you do the thing that in microarray the data will be kind of horizontal, and in other cases the data will be more like vertical. And in microarrays, the columns are each one is what is each column is a experiment, and you need an extra information design type. No, it's a target table. Called target in the literature, that essentially describe what are the conditions for every experiment. You need an extra information to an extra table that describes the conditions. Okay. So, but the bottom line that I want to focus here in the main difference is that in LM, in linear models, you have a formula for describing the model. And in LM-FIT, you have a matrix. So we have two ways of describing the thing, and I want to talk in two things, essentially. One, how you make this thing, how you move from one to the other. And second, what is the meaning of it? This was kind of the recurring question. What is the meaning of the thing? Because at the end of the day, the computer do everything for you except deciding what is the model. So the real work that you have, well, after you get the data, of course, getting data is not so easy, but after you get the data, the real problem is how to model it. Okay. And if you only get data and you don't think about the modeling, you probably are going to lose your time because the data itself doesn't speak. People have today a kind of a lot of faith in big data that say that data will speak to me. Doesn't happen. Data doesn't speak. You need a model. You need a model. So the first thing, there is a function called model matrix. You put the formula like y depending of x, and you get a matrix. So that is the easy part. If you have the formula and you want to know the matrix, you use matrix model. Model matrix. Okay. Then the question is what do they mean? You can even do the matrix manually, one by one, writing with pen and paper, and then copying to R or Excel, whatever. But you need to know the math. So math at the end of the day is what connects everything here. And I know that some of you were told that you can study biology because you can be scientist without doing math. They lied to you. You cannot do any science without doing math, no? Because math is the way nature works. You cannot understand nature without understanding math. So, a simple version, this is the formula that we have seen many times, will not surprise anybody. The response, gene expression, depends on a base condition, a baseline, plus something that depends on the factor that we control. I don't know, stress or food. In the typical case was a weight of the person dependent on the height, okay? So this formula can be rewritten as a matrix. If I send you a link to the matrix multiplication, it should be easy for you to say that here for every I, look at the center. The center is the generic case, but you start from the one to the n, where n is the number of samples that we have. So y sub I is equal to 1 times beta 0 plus xi times beta 1. Okay? Remember that it's rows by columns. So essentially, you have to think that these two things are the first correspond to the first column and the second correspond to the second column. Okay? The first constant to the first column, the second constant to the second column. And then there is a vector of the error, the residuals. And the idea of fitting is to make this small. So that is why it's called the least square method. Okay, maybe we have not said that, but there is another name that the least square. Because we want to make this number small for technical reasons. Okay. Any questions so far? Are you with me? So this kind of thing should be something that you should be comfortable. And at the end, it's kind of practice. Because you realize that this is the matrix. This is the design matrix. If you want the formula, if you have the mathematical formula, mathematical expression, let's say, then you write it like a matrix. And this is the design matrix. Okay? What the design matrix is doing is change, well, the syntaxes for formulas in R is not exactly the syntaxes of mathematics. And in my opinion, it's more clear if you go to the mathematic formula. And let's be honest, you always need to write the mathematical formula just to explain to other people and to explain to yourself. The reason we write math is to keep us honest, to avoid mistake. Not to fool ourselves. Well, if we have more than one independent variable, let's say x1 and x2, here the matrix is a little more complex. And here I forgot to put the constant. I will fix this later. There should be a 1 here. Let me go to the general case. Just one comment here. The beta 0 here is the intercept. This slide is not finished. I'm sorry. But so let me go to the general case. In general, you can have many columns, okay? Many independent variables. You can have, let's say, weight, size of the hand, income, average grade, whatever. You can have many, many things that you measure. Can be numeric or can be 1-0, like factors represented with 1-0. Okay? So this is naturally, they had to be numbers, but sometimes they represent a numeric value, sometimes represent a factor. So beta zero is the value of the average value, if you like, of y when all the x are zero. Or let's say the gene expression when the conditions are baseline. Okay? When there is nothing changing. The xij will represent the change, the conditions, either concentration of something that you can control, or the tissue, diet, whatever. And beta zero will be the baseline. Okay? Then the beta 1 to beta k are going to be the effects. Okay, I call it the slope, or sometimes I kind of the change. But I think the best way to describe it, these are the effects of the each one of the conditions of the independent variables in the outcome. Okay, and this is why we care, because we want to know the effects. We want to know from our data. Our data will be, this is the result of our experiment. These are the conditions that we controlled or measured. But what we really want to know are these, what are the effects? What is the baseline condition and what are the effects? Okay, this is the real question that you want to solve. Well, not always we use intercept. Sometimes you will like to have a model without intercept, which it is useful when the x represents a factor, but it's not necessarily correct when x is a number. Okay? Because the point is this: if let's say that this was the weight of the person, and this is the height of the person, and this is, I don't know, the hand span of the person, okay? And you will try to model the weight of the person depending. And essentially what we are saying is that a person, let's say this, a person with average weight and average, a person with zero weight and zero hand span will have zero height. And that is kind of not necessarily realistic. We are forcing every line to cross through zero. In other words, when the independent variables are numeric, this model may not be correct. That is why we have always an intercept. An intercept makes it more realistic. Now, when we have a factor, these are going to be 1 and 0, and then in that case, it may be more realistic. You probably can guess that in the generic case here is essentially the same that we had before, without the one column, the column of ones that doesn't exist in this case. Okay. Now we have said this before, but I want to put, because maybe I never wrote it explicitly, but here this x can be any number, and in particular, if we have a factor, we have a factor f, let's say. And factors are things that have levels, okay? They are discrete values like sex or diet or, I don't know, stress condition, tissue. They are not necessarily ordered. I mean, we have blood, brain, and breast, and there is not a natural order there, because they don't need to be. They just to be different. So these three names that I give you, breast, blood, and brain, are going to be the levels of the factor. And the factor will be a variable that will represent which tissue we took the sample from. Then k is the number of levels, f is a factor, and then we represent this factor with a matrix with k columns, in which every cell will have a 1 if that individual has the corresponding level. So one column for every level, one row for every individual, and you get a 1 when the factor is correct and 0 when the factor is not. Okay, trivial example that we have seen, sex. We model a simple model of weight depending on sex. We have a factor depending on the first level and a factor depending on the second level. Here, the first level, the way that we did was female. So X of column one will be one when the person is a female and zero when it's male. Of course, the second is the contrary, zero when it's female and one when it's male. And when we do the model, this beta will be the mean value of Y for all female, the mean value of weight or whatever variable that we are measuring, okay? This will be kind of redundant, as we have seen this before, but I wanted to write it explicitly. So you can make, the point is that you can make your own matrix if you know what are the factors here, okay? No, and sometimes it's good to do the matrix manually, but in general, you want to use R to do the work for you. You don't want to, the computer is here to help you. So these are the basic formula that I wanted to show you here. Let's say that X is a numerical variable. And then when you write Y depending on X, I'm going to give you a meaning of this tilde. This tilde essentially means that there is a combination like this and an error. This error is essentially implicit in this tilde. This is kind of the formula for Y is a constant plus something depending on X plus some error. That is why it's not an equal. It's kind of similar to. This wave is kind of similar to. Or let's say Y is modeled as a formula depending on X. Now, for reasons that are not very clear to me, they decided that because when you use a numerical variable, it makes sense to always have an intercept. So if you don't say anything, you will have an intercept, a beta zero, and then a factor for every X. If you want to not have if you don't want to have an intercept, if you want to omit the intercept, then you have to explicitly say X plus zero. So the plus zero is kind of silly because adding zero, but in this context, in the context of formulas in R, it represents how to tell R that you don't want an intercept. By the way, you realize that this part is R specific, but the mathematic part is not R specific. The reason why I teach math is because I don't know if you are going to use R, I don't know if you are going to use Excel or GraphPad or whatever. No matter the program that you use, the math is going to be the same. Computers don't solve problems. Mathematics solves this problem. Computers just do the mathematics fast. But you really need to understand the math. Well, if you have more than one independent variable, you can have x1, x2, x3, and you will get the beta 1, beta 2, beta 3. And if you add 0, then you don't have intercept. So this formula works for all the cases. OK? Any questions so far? It should be straight for everybody. With factors, as we say, you have a factor with like F here. And if you run the formula F plus zero, there is no intercept. Then essentially the formula means that you have one beta for every condition, for every level, okay? One to K levels. And well, you read here, one when it's the obvious thing. So I have an example here. I have a factor ABC. And I wrote the model, and you see you get one for A, and in the first is A, so you get a one. The second is B, you get a one. I could have done more, but I didn't have space in the table. Okay, in the slide. Okay. Now, what if you have an intercept? Here things start to get interesting / complicated. So far, I think everything was straight. When you have an intercept, you will notice that the columns don't include A. We start from the second level. We skip the first level. That is the first thing that you have to keep in mind. When you have an intercept, you will skip one of the level. And in R is the first. And so it is critical to choose which is the first level because that is going to be the baseline. Okay. If you have an intercept. If you don't have an intercept, that is not a problem. But if you have an intercept, you want to choose it carefully. So you see here, we have intercept is always one because by definition, because it's multiplied by this beta zero multiplied by one always. And then you have a factor depending on beta, on B factor for C, flag for B, flag for C indicator. Okay, so there is a lot of details in R when you read the literature of how to choose the level. You make the factor and you have to specify the levels in the order that you want. There's a function called relevel or something like that. So if you are going this way, you have to be careful. I'm going to give you an alternative later. What's the meaning here? Well, we have told this before. I will one time to make it explicit when this was the formula for the factor. So the intercept, the beta zero, it will be to the mean or of beta zero for all cases when the factor is the first factor. In this case, for example, beta zero will be the average for A, okay? Because it's the baseline. So beta zero will be the average of all the Y values when the factor is equal to level one. The factor value is the first level. Okay? When we did sex versus weight, or weight versus sex, the first level was female, so we got the average of female. Then if one of the beta j for j greater than zero will be the difference of means between the two levels, the level j, so beta j for level j versus level one. So the second column, the second coefficient will be the difference of the average between the second factor minus the first factor, okay? And the first is fixed. So for different j, you have different j here, but the one is fixed. So this formula is always saying A versus B, A versus C, A versus D, A versus... If you have 300 factors, they are all comparing with the first. Sometimes what you want, sometimes not what you want. So for that cases, and in general to answer any questions that you want to answer, we do contrast. And I have spoken about this very quickly, and now I want to make it super formal because at the end is what I think is the real way to do it. And in particular, in microarray analysis is super important. Okay, microarray analysis at the end, this is what you end doing. Or in general, gene expression. I mean, when you use Lima, in Lima, contrasts are super important. And in fact, they have some function to help you do that thing. And to me, at the end, it's also an easier way to handle factors. So what if instead of comparing the third with the first, we want to compare the third with the second and the second with the third? For example, let's say that you are following the gene expression two times. So you have time one, time two, time three, time four. So one question is comparing everything with the first day, which is kind of the absolute chain versus the baseline. But a different question will be the daily change from day one to day two, then from day two to day three, are different questions. Notice that you may have a little change every day that is not significant, but at the end of the day, after 1 week or so, the change may be significant. So the questions are different. So in this case, a model with intercept doesn't work. We cannot do this with the framework that we discussed. Instead, we will have a model without intercepts and with contrast. Okay. So In Lima, there is a, and I suggest it's a starting part. You have a function called make contrast that takes a description of the contrast that you want to do. And you have to say what are the levels, what is the factor that you're using, or something like that. So we describe what we want and what are all, we have to say what are all the possible levels with a factor or something like that. And we have to describe what we want. For example, we say we want C minus B and B minus A from the factors in for the levels in this factor F. The levels are A, B, C, and the contrast that we want is C minus B and B minus A. Now, question. Do you see how the contrasts are encoded here? Do you understand this matrix? Will you be able to do this without the help of R?
Without intercept?
Yeah, without intercept.
Yeah, I think we can do it. It's fairly easy. If we match the columns A, B, C, we are getting. So in A, we should get 1 for A and 0 for others if we are not using intercept. And C minus B tells us.
Yeah, but yeah, watch. This is not the design matrix. This is not the design matrix. This is not a matrix that will tell you for every individual. The design matrix has one row for every individual, for every experiment, and one column for every independent variable. Here we are combining independent variables. This is a small matrix. It doesn't depend on your data, it depends on your model. So let's say if you have 10 observations of 1 million observations, the contrast is going to be the same. It's independent of the number of things. Now, I want you to focus, for example, in the last column, the column B minus A. What are the numbers that you put in the column B minus A?
Minus 1 and 1.
But why?
Because in B, we have 0, and in A, we will have 1. So if we...
I don't see where you say that B we have 0 and A we have 1. I don't see where you get that.
So I was thinking about for each level, for A, I was thinking 1 and B. Since we are looking at A, we won't see the B, so it's 0.
And thinking about columns.
Yeah.
Marish, any opinion here?
I think what I'm thinking is I'm constructing constructing the columns with the rows and the
okay.
So I got the B minus A for minus 1 and 1 for A and B rows. So thinking about it, we can derive to.
Okay, I think you got the idea, but you are not explaining it very well. Do you want to try to explain it again?
I mean, this is the last contrast matrix. So if I want to make it back to the rows, just the rows as without contrasts, we can derive some functions from some equations from not functions equations from these rows and columns to get back to A, B, and C.
Yeah, but it's a long story.
Yeah.
Anybody else want to give an interpretation on how you make this matrix? It is super easy. It is super easy.
Mm-hmm.
Shall I say it? Let me say it. For have B minus A, you need to get 1 of B and minus 1 of A. Okay? B minus A is 1 of B minus 1 of A. So you put 1 in the row of B and minus 1 in the row of A. If you want to have C minus B, you don't take any A. You take 1 minus b, o sea, minus 1, b, and 1c.
Oh.
Okay?
Yeah.
Okay. So it is a way to say c minus b, a way to express that concept of c minus b is you don't need any a, you need to multiply b by minus 1, you need to multiply c by 1, and put them all together. Okay. Essentially, you look at the what is the number, the coefficient multiplying each one of these things. Here, you b is multiplied by 1, a is multiplied by minus 1, and c is multiplied by 0. So this is the essence here. Well, make contrast helps you, okay? But we will see that it's not always something we can do. If you are using Lima, this is the easy way, and probably the most correct way. You make your model. Well, let me show you. This is how we do things in Lima. We make the initial design matrix with this function. We solve a model matrix, and we have the factor that we want, maybe more than one factor, and plus zero, because we don't want intercept here. Okay, we are not going to use intercept, we are going to use contrast. Okay, then we can immediately, in fact, fit the data to this design matrix. Okay, and the fitted value essentially will have the average for every factor. Okay, let's say average for diet 1, average for diet 2, average for diet 3, whatever. Okay, then you make a contrast matrix with the function that we say. The level here, you can take the design matrix. Okay, the design matrix will give you the levels. And this will make essentially the same matrix that you saw before. And then in Lima, you have a function called contrast fit, that you take the fit that you had before and the contrast that you just make, and they are combined, and you get something called fit contrast, which is a fitted value, but with the contrast applied. Essentially, initially you have A, B, C, and now you have, initially you have three columns, let's say A, B, C, and now you have two columns, psi minus B, and B minus A. Okay, this is what contrast fit does. It combines the original thing that you have, A, B, C, that you get from the model matrix, A, B, C. It combines them and you get B minus A and C minus B, because you put them in the contrast matrix, okay? And at the end, you do this empirical bias to get the p-values and things like that. But the contrast is done here. Okay, so basically two steps. One is to fit the model without intercept that will give you the average for every condition, for every level of the factor. And then combine it with a contrast matrix that will give you a fitted, will adapt the fitted model to the contrast. Okay, we'll combine them in the way that you describe in the contrast matrix. Okay.
Is there an easier way to just write C minus B or B minus A if you're having from A to K, let's say we have like 40 values?
Ah, good question. Very good question. I don't know. I don't know. If there are more, what I do essentially, I do the design matrix manually. If that happens, sometimes it's easier to say, okay, what are my input? What are my output? And I do maybe first in paper and then I write the code. You can even do it in Excel and copy to R or something like that. Yeah, because these are a helper function that essentially allow you to write kind of formulas like here, and they make the matrix. But honestly, what really works is the matrix. The real thing is matrix. And we are kind of making the computer make the matrix for us. But if it's too much work to tell the computer what is a matrix, you just do the matrix. That is why it was important, this point, how you make. So in Lima, essentially, you have one row for every level, and one column for every contrast that you want to make. And the contrast, you write the formula, and in the formula you find what are the coefficients for every number. One of beta, one of b, good, minus one of a, good, and zero of c. You can have other combinations. You can have, let's say, b plus c minus a, or something that I will give you a homework later. Maybe you want to compare each one with the average. You have, let's say, a plus b plus c divided by 3, and you want to contrast with a and or with b or with c. You kind of take the center. You want to compare everything with the center. That is something that can be done here. Okay? Well, here I wanted to first, what is the point here? You can do whatever you want with the contrast. Well, in certain limits, but all the interesting question that we have will be probably handled with the contrast. Second, the contrast are at the end encoded in matrices, okay? The secret is that everything is a matrix here. Everything is matrix. This is just matrices. Matrix. That's why I give you a summary of matrix. Everything is just matrix. And I will tell you another secret. When we study networks, they are also matrices. Everything is a matrix. Huh? We are in the matrix. Okay, sorry. So, Lima. And then you should therefore it's useful at least to write your own matrices. Okay, you make the computer multiply for you, and you don't need to spend time doing the multiplications, of course. But at least to be able to say in a matrix what you want to say. Okay. Okay. Probably the first question is, think what you really want to say. That may be the first question. What you really want to say? What is the contrast? In my observation of the talk that I have been in the last month, this tends to be the most important part. You know, what are the thing? What do we want to know? What's the question? Well, that is always the question. That is always the limiting of this thing. What is the question? You remember the first class, I say we have to start by thinking what we really want to know. Then, okay, levels. You can make your own, you can ask questions and you can write a matrix that represents the question. And then there is a protocol that is essentially this. Of course, here you will change the formula corresponding to the thing that your particular experiment, and the contrast will also depend on your experiment, but the rest is pretty much the same always. Okay, you change the formula here and you change the formula here, depending on the question, biological question that you are asking, and the math is done for you in the computer. Okay, how we do this in the standard linear model? Well, this was a big trouble for me because I really struggled to understand this. Last time I teach this course, I could not understand this thing. And probably still don't understand correctly, but I get disappointed of the contrast option of LM. LM, the simple linear model, has a function, an option called contrast, but it only works with intercepts. At least I could not make it work without intercept. And that is not what I want to do. So because it always limits me to use a constant value. Well, sometimes you can feed your case, but it's annoying to me. And I didn't know how to handle more than one factor at the time. I really didn't know. So instead of that, I want to do the math directly. Because as I say, the problems are solved with math. And then the computer do it for you. So I want to get three values that I am going to beta one, beta two. Sorry, let's say, let's start from the beginning. We want C minus B and B minus A. This is going to be my new beta one and my new beta two. Okay, these are the things that at the end in the model I want to see. And I need a beta three essentially because you need the same number of equations as variables. We have A, B, C. So we need beta one, beta two, beta three, okay? It's something that kind of everybody should know, that if to solve the system, you need to have as many conditions as variables. Otherwise, essentially, the degrees of freedom should be zero. If you have more degrees of freedom, then you don't have a solution. You have too much freedom. Okay, everybody agree. If you have three levels, you need three outputs here. Later we may drop them. Nobody forced you to see if you don't want, but you need to do the model. And then we do the matrix. Sorry, one step before. Oh my gosh, here. Went too fast. So I wrote the equations again, and I wrote the equations in matrix form, okay? Here, bear with me, because this is a change. You remember that I said that in linear models, in LM, the data is in columns, and in Lima, data is in rows. And that essentially means that the contrast here should be by row and not by column. That is the problem of switching between Lima and standard linear models, that we are going rows instead of columns. So this is essentially the same thing that we saw before. For beta 1, C minus B, you have 1 minus B and 1 C. So remember, the first column is A, the second column is B, the third column is C. Okay. This is essentially the same thing that we saw before, but rows instead of columns. Okay. And that is because they handle the data in the opposite direction. Okay. Everybody see here that first the matrix multiplication is clear for everybody here. Yep.
Yes.
So, and to me, it's kind of easy to understand. The order with column was kind of tricky, but essentially, you can read C. Beta 1, C minus B. So beta 1, 0, A, minus 1, B, 1, C. C minus B. Beta 2, minus A, plus B. No C. Beta 3, A. 0, B, 0, C. 1, A, 0, B. If you do it often, you will find it supernatural, which is what happened to me. This, to me, writing this and writing the kind of the lower part to me is better than the first. I'm so much used to this that this is the way that I see the world, not the system of equation is kind of more complicated. And why this is useful? Because matrix, square matrix, can sometimes be inverted. You have the inverse of the matrix. And you may remember there in the high school or something, but don't worry, the computer do for you. You don't need to know how to inverse the matrix. You just need to know that matrix, square matrices, the matrix can be inverted. They have to be square and they have to be good. Not always, but in all the cases that we will care, they will be, you will be able to find an inverse and the computer can do it for you. Okay. So let's do the matrix in R. So here in this case, to be honest, I did the matrix manually. I said that you may use make contracts, but it is not enough. First, because you remember make contract has two problems. One, it gives you columns instead of rows. Second, it didn't give a square matrix. So I had to add rows to make it square, okay? But here I wrote a matrix that I call contrast with essentially the story that I want to say. A, B, C in the columns and the rows, the contrast. C minus B, B minus A. Let me say it this way. In the columns, you put what you have. The thing that we measure. In the rows, you put what you want to have. Okay. It is easy to measure the average of A, the average of B, the average of C. And what you really want to do is to get C, B, and A. Okay. So one row for every equation. In make contrast, it's one column for every equation. So you can use make contrast, but be careful. At the end, I am doing it manually. Okay. It's not so hard. Then, as I say, we need to inverse the matrix or solve the equation system. And depending on the tool that you use, you in Excel, there's a function for this. In R, you do it with a nice command called solve. Solve is calculate the inverse of a matrix. And this essentially gives you the way that we are going to have. This tells you how to change the design matrix. So in the design matrix, we will have A, B, C. And we are going to multiply the design matrix. Remember, the design matrix has A, B, C in the columns. And we are going to multiply with this at A, B, C in the rows. So we can remember rows by column. Row by column. So the rows of A, and I don't know if I'm doing the correct order. This is your A. Then the sign matrix, ABC, and then the contrast matrix, ABC in the rows, and the result will be C minus B, B minus A, and A. Okay? First, we make the design matrix. This is the equivalent protocol here. We make the design matrix as we did before without intercept. Each column represents a level. Then we update the design to a design with contrast. We take the design matrix and we multiply with the inverse of the contrast. This symbol here is the matrix multiplication in R. Okay, depending on your language, matrix multiplication is different, but it's not the simple multiplication because in R it has a different meaning. The official matrix multiplication of row by columns is percentage star percentage, okay? And that will be you. Let me give you the visual thing. I think this should be clear. Let's say that the original design matrix was three times A, three times B, three times C, okay? A, B, 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 C, 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 okay? This was the original. Essentially, it is marking that the first three are A, the second three are B, and the and if we do the linear model with this, you will take the average for condition A, the average for condition B, and the average for condition C. Okay? After we multiply by the matrix, you get this design matrix. C minus B here, B minus A, one sometime. So this is not obvious a priori. Okay? With time, you start to find the logic, but to me, it is better to kind of follow it automatically instead of just doing manually. So let me show you one more time. You get the design matrix from the formula and the contrast that you write in a matrix, a square matrix, and you do this multiplication here, okay? Finally, to fit the model, we have this trick. The dependent variable, depending on dot plus zero, and the data is the design with contrast. Okay. This formula requires some explanation. Dot here represent all the variables in the column. It's a little like Punch asked. We have many columns. It can be hundreds, depending on the number of levels. So it will be annoying to write one by one. So what we do instead, we just say, use everything. And plus zero meaning without intercept. So this formula is essentially saying that don't care about anything, and all the important thing is in the design matrix. We do our design matrix in the way that we are going to use it. Okay, essentially, we encode everything in the design matrix. We take all the raw data, we process it, and we do the contrast. Okay? Any questions so far? So this expression is tricky, but you don't need to think about it because it will always be the same. Answer, this is a expression, it's just to trick, I mean, just tricking R to say, just use the matrix. The meaning of dot plus zero is just use the matrix, don't think about it, okay? And I make sure that the matrix will do what I want to do, okay? Okay, all this will be useless if we cannot do statistics here. And that was a question that someone asked me last week. Like, because remember, you can always take average one by one and take the difference of average. If you are only looking at the average value, there are simple ways to. You don't need to use a linear model if you are only comparing averages. But what you really want to do is to take a confidence interval, in other words, standard errors, in other words, variances. And the big hypothesis that we do when we put everything in a linear model is that all the underlying variances are the same. All the noise, all the variability that we see is coming from the same origin of noise, the same variance. Okay, that is the big hypothesis. So, I give you a PDF some time ago and explaining how the variance of a sum. But if you make it more general, if you have two variables, let's say xj and xk, and you sum them, eventually multiplying by plus one or minus one, this lambda and rho, you can think that are plus minus one, like the contrast. Okay, this may be one, this may be minus one. Or maybe something like one third or whatever, the number that you will get from the contrast. A combination of the original columns. Okay, you have the column for A, the column for B, and we are making a combination, let's say B minus A. Okay, that B minus A will be minus one here plus one here. Well, the variance of the combined column is lambda squared, the variance of the first, rho squared, the lambda of the second, plus two times lambda rho covariance. Okay? I give you a PDF which it doesn't show exactly this thing, but if you do the manual thing, the manual computation, you will find that if you put a lambda here and a rho here, well, it will work. I will update the PDF eventually. Then covariance, it also happens if the covariance of one variable with itself is equivalent, it's the same number as the variance. You see the formula. So the covariance was the first minus the average times the second minus the average. The sum of first minus the average times second minus the average. If the first and the second are the same, is the variable minus the average squared. So, and you can do covariance of anything. So, here, this with more time, I will make it in a longer matrix. But the story is this: we have a matrix. You can easily calculate a matrix called the covariance matrix, or sometimes people say variance covariance matrix, in which you essentially in every row and every column you have the covariance of variable A and variable I and J. Or J and K, if you like, here. Okay? In the diagonal of this matrix, you will have the variances. This is a matrix that we will see one day. It is automatically calculated when you do the linear model, and it's the metric that you need essentially to calculate the standard errors. Okay, you need to know the variance of every column and the covariance between columns. Okay, so you have them in a matrix. And the trick of having in a matrix that here I can't see the covariance matrix, you find that the variance of a combination of columns can be solved pre-multiplying and post-multiplying the matrix. I mean, you do two multiplications, one from the left as a row, one from the right as a column. In other words, and sorry, one more step. These values here are the contrast. So let's say the variance of, maybe I should put the whiteboard. If we have time, I do it in the whiteboard. The variance of one time a minus one time b will be here you have a 1 minus 1, and here you have a 1 minus 1. You multiply the matrix, and you will get exactly the same expression that we have before. So look, this formula is ugly, it's complicated. This formula is clean. And these values here are the ones I minus one from the contrast. In other words, this is a short version. The contrast matrix also updates the covariance matrix. And I didn't put it here, but the point is that when you use a linear model with contrast, the variance that you get are the correct variances. Therefore, the standard errors are the correct standard errors for the contrast. And therefore, the confidence intervals are corresponding to the thing that you want to calculate, and the p-values are the thing that you want to calculate. So everything works. Everything works. The contrast matrix is used to update the design. And when you do that, what end up happening is that you update the covariance matrix. Okay? I didn't show the detail of how this happened because, I mean, it will take probably one class, and that I promise to do at the end. It will be matrix, 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 but one day we will do. What you need to know, the intuition is this, that any combination of columns, including the contrast, will have a variance that we can calculate using the same contrast. Okay? If we know the covariance initial, we use the contrast to get the variance combined. Okay? Moreover, you don't need to use this formula. Okay, you need to know that this happened behind. The linear model do it for you automatically. You don't need to do this. What you need to know is that you can trust the p-values of the model when you use contrast. Okay, you can trust them because they make sense. Okay. Well, I have other two small details that are not necessarily connected to this, but I wanted to say now. One here is for a couple of people that are not here. So I hope that Jeren and Atakan will tell Elif Yilmaz and so, because this is something that I see over and over. Let me say this example. Here, I have two values, y1 and y2, to measure them. That for this example, I want to think that they are the expression of genes. And here, I just take 1,000 replicas, and they are random, values between 1 and 100. You do the experiment many times, okay? And they are completely random. And like in many cases, you use one as a reference, let's say the housekeeping gene, let's say, or the initial condition. And then Y2 is the challenge, what happened later. So something that people tend to do a lot, since I have a thing to normalize, I divide, you make this division. The new value divided by the old value. That is the ratio, okay? And you want to see the ratio, okay? Makes sense to you? Let me say, here when I say sample, you imagine that you're really sampling. You are really taking a sample from the tube, from the plant, from the culture, whatever. So you have two samples, sample one and sample two, and you want to compare them. In many cases, people do that comparison with a ratio, because you say, okay, this is the level here, and I want to see if it increases, decreases the change, okay? Normalization, okay? But the point is that you are normalizing by something that is also changing with the experiment. The Y1 is not a constant. It's something that depends on your experimental data. It's noisy. So if you do the experiment many times, you will find something like this, that in some cases, the number can be very high. And most of the cases, they are all very short. And here I put in the red line, that is the threshold for saying this is going up or down. So looking at this, what do you think that will happen? Well, if it can happen that you get a rate of super high and you say, oh, it changed a lot. It went up a lot. It's super clear that it went up a lot because it's more than 60 times. Or you may say, okay, it went up a little. That happens a lot of times. Or you are very close to you can calculate the standard deviation here is going to be very big because the numbers are very high. So the interval for zero or for one in this case, for the null hypothesis is going to be big. So most of these cases are going to say, no, there is no change here. So you essentially have two options. Let's say 80% of the time, let's say, you will say nothing happened. And in the 20% of the time, you will say it changed, and it changed a lot. Well, my point that I try to explain every time I see this, that this is not a correct comparison, because if the numbers are going down, everything is going to be in the opposite direction. And moreover, if you normalize it the other way, if you normalize Y1 divided by Y2, you will get a completely different picture. The high number will be very low between 0 and 1. I mean, let's say this. If the expression is increasing, you have a lot of freedom to move. If the expression is decreasing, everything is compressed between 0 and 1. So this is a bad idea. Instead, you take log. And you got this. This is random. This is a simulation that I did now in the computer. But what does it look? What do you see here?
Normal distribution.
Yeah. Maybe not 100% normal, but bell-shaped and normal enough for me. Normal enough. So symmetrical, bell-shaped, and if not an exact normal, close enough that we can use the tools that we are using. So if you take the ratios, you get something that is crazy. It's probably an exponential or something that the tools that we are using now don't work. If you take log, you get normal. Okay. Your noise is normal or close enough to normal. Of course, now the null hypothesis is zero, not one. Because, I mean, the log of one is zero. And moreover, the log of the division is the difference of the logs, you know, the magic of logarithm. So you get something else for free with log, that instead of dividing, you are taking minus, and you are comparing two numbers, and that is a linear model. So if you take logs, you put again, everything in the context of linear models. So when normalizing, instead of taking radius, take log radius. The noise is going to be much better. You even got here for distribution, for deltas, for standard deviation. The null hypothesis is very clear. The way to test this is very clear. So only wins using log. At least take a look, take a look. No, the high cases are as much as the low cases. You see that the gene expression can increase or can decrease with the same frequency. Okay. Which is the case because, let me show you again. These two numbers are random with the same logic. The same minimum, the same maximum, same size. These are two random numbers that on average are the same. A number random between 1 and 100, on average they are the same. If instead of sample you want to use another, you can test with different simulations, but you at the end you will always find that using log you get something that is much more symmetrical and centered around the null hypothesis that nothing happened here. Okay. In this case, the null hypothesis is true. These two numbers are intrinsically the same. And the difference that we see are given by noise. If you don't use log, you will have a lot of cases that look different. A lot of cases that no, but a lot of cases that look different. And never negative cases. If you take log, then it will work as it intends to be worked. Okay, you will have a few outliers, of course, but that's part of life. I mean, the p-value means that the null hypothesis will be rejected 1% of time, 5% of time. Okay. Second detail that I was pending is this, a comment about power. And here I probably should explain a little more, but I want to give an example and then explain. Because we spoke about a lot about p-value, and you know that you want to have a small p-value, but the question, there is a different question, like, if we have a very small p-value, we may not be able to see what we want to see. We may not be able to see the chain that we want to see. So here I have some data that I took from this was a simulation that I made intentionally to because I know what is the real difference here. So we have three replicas, and I don't know, five genes. Okay, so and these are log radius, of course. I already convinced you that this number can be negative or positive, so -6, 5, 5. So the question, of course, is the average different from zero? Or let's make a confidence interval for the average. Between us, the average is different from zero, but the variance is very big. The average is one, but the standard deviation is more than one. So it's very noisy. So, and that is the typical case that happens in biology because you have a lot of variability. So the first row are these numbers. The average is this. This is standard deviation. You can calculate directly here. And we have three values. We are estimating one value. That is the mean. So we have 3 - 1 degrees of freedom. And then since we are using the sample mean, we have to use a t distribution. So the t distribution for 95% confidence and 2 degrees of freedom give me this. Therefore, the confidence interval for the number is something between -2 and 3. Remember, the real value was 1. So yeah, the the interval contain the real value, but also contain zero. So I don't have enough data to reject the null hypothesis. The null hypothesis is that the average is zero. So the genes seem not to be differential expressor. And let me repeat again. These are simulated data. I did this simulated data fixing that the average should be one, but I give a big standard error. Okay, a big standard deviation. So, and we have very few samples. We have three replicas, which is the typical case that people do. Three replicas, in this case, are not enough to see the difference. So the question of power is this. With this experiment, will we be able to see the difference that really exists? Which is a kind of different question than the p-value. The p-value essentially is like avoiding false positive. What is the probability that I have a false positive? The power is avoiding false negatives. Here, the truth is there is a differential expression because I made it in the original data, but the test cannot find it. Okay? The test cannot find the differential expression. So I don't, this experiment doesn't have enough power to find the differential expression that really exists because the noise is too big and the number of samples too small. I think I have somewhere, I repeated this with more data and then the intervals are narrower and then you can see it. So more replicas, you do better. I repeated with the second gene. In this case, the mean is a little higher, the standard deviation is narrower. So in this case, the 95% interval does not contain zero. So it seems that the gene is differential expressed. So in this case, we reject the null hypothesis. We say the gene is differential expressed. Notice that the real value is one, which is not exactly the center of this interval, but it's in the interval. But if for some reason you want to do not with 5%, but with 1%, then the t distribution with 2 degrees of freedom is super big. So the 99% confidence interval design contains zero, so no, we cannot reject. Well, this is the last slide I have. So I probably should add a slide explaining what I'm saying with words now, but what I'm saying is that a question that should be asked is not only the p-value, like it's not only that, are we getting false positive? You want to make your p-value small because essentially you want to say, if my experiment show differential expression, I want that differential expression to be real, not just noise, okay? That is the role of p-value, that the separate the signal from noise, okay? So if I see differential expression, then I want to be very sure that is differential expression. The p-value is the probability that I am wrong in that case, okay? Then, well, not exactly, but you get the idea. Not exactly that, but you get the idea that the small p-value reduces the probability that you are wrong when you say this guy, this gene is differential expressed. But there is an opposite question, like, what if the gene was really differentially expressed, but we don't see it? Okay, let me reframe it. Let's say that the genes are people who are being judged, and you essentially, the p-value say that you don't want to send an innocent to the jail. Okay? You don't want to send an innocent. So you make the p-value small the null hypothesis is that what is the null hypothesis here? We reject the null hypothesis If we reject the null hypothesis, we see this person is innocent. Is that?
Null should be he is guilty. So we can reject that statement. No?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Null is that is guilty. And we reject, when we reject the null hypothesis, we say it's innocent. And essentially the point is that we don't want to say that it's guilty, someone that is innocent. So that is why we get the small p-value, no? The probability that we say that is guilty when, no, it's the other way. Okay, should prepare this better. But okay, I have to think better what is the null hypothesis or not, but the one point is that you don't want to send an innocent to jail. So the p-value is the probability that you send an innocent to jail. That is it, okay? The probability that someone who was innocent look differential expressa, look guilty. So you want to make that number small. If the person is really innocent, you don't want to send it to jail. You don't want to say it as guilty. But the problem is, if you do it very kind of, I will not say nobody to the jail, then the problem is that you have guilty people that should be in jail and you are not sending it to jail. There are genes that are differential expressed that you are not seeing as differential expressed. I will stop sharing because I don't have more slides. So this question is a little more complicated because the null hypothesis is very clear, usually. The null hypothesis is normally that everything is zero. The alternative hypothesis is not so clear because, I mean, normally the alternative hypothesis is like, okay, the expression is different from zero. But what do you mean different from zero? 0.1, 1, 10? You to calculate the power, you need to ask yourself, what is the change of difference of expression? What is the differential expression that I want to see, to be able to see? In other words, do I want to see an increase in 50% or 100% or 200%? How much should the gene change so we can see it? Or in other words, what is the change of concentration that has a biological meaning? If you know that, let's say that you want to have a fold change of one, meaning that the concentration increased twice, okay, the log fold, remember, is the log of two, so log fold change of one, log fold change of one means twice the concentration. If you want to see that, then from previous experiment or something like that, you need to know what is your noise level. Meaning that genes that are really differential expressed by one, how much change in your experiment? I mean, if the numbers are always like 0.9 and 1.1, you are great. But if the numbers are too small or even negative, like in this case that I show you, here the differential expression is one. But the noise is big. So with three replicas, I am not able to see it. Okay. How you do that in practice? Well, it can be done with pen and paper and some math, but the way that I teach normally is to make a simulation. My bottom line in this case is that before you do an experiment, try to find on NCBI or in the literature, similar experiment that people have done with similar conditions, or look in your own previous experiment and see what are the variabilities, what are the variances that you get in your experiment. Remember that what you really want to measure is variance. What you really want to measure is variance. So if you know what is your variance, what is the variability in your tools, and what is the variability in nature, remember that we have noise and we have natural variability. If you know these two things, then you can make a simulation and simulate the experiment that you are going to do and see what percentage of time you see the result that you want to see. If the differential expression is 3, will you see it? If the differential expression is 2, 1, 0, 5, when you will be able to see it? And that is one of the reasons, I think, why we take a log fault chain when we filter. We filter the p-values. We filter typically with log fault chain equal one, because it's something that we will be able to see. We have more chance that we will see. Okay. I again had a question mark in the face. So I think that I'm going to eventually write you a detail in PDF to keep you for memory, so you don't need to read the slides every time. But these were the things that I had to tell you before finishing, because I was feeling very, very bad that I never explained really good the contrast part and how the p-values still work, okay? And the power issue. The power is important. When you are doing the experiment, you need to know, or at least evaluate a posteriori, if your genes are not differential expressed. The question is, why are not differential expressed? There are two possibilities. One, that they are really not differential expressed, so you don't see them. Or second, they are differential expressed, but your experiment is not able to see them. So if I don't see differential expression, why I don't see? That is the power question. Why I don't see differential expression? Okay? And the last point is log ratios. Never ratios, always log ratios. Okay? Any question? Last question? No? So I'm going to stop recording.